call the Cabinet to order. Can I welcome everybody to this meeting of Cabinet? Thank you for your attendance. Before I do anything else, I'm just going to ask us to just stand, please, for a minute in memory of former Councillor Rob Gregson, who sadly has passed away. Rob was a great representative for the Brighton. Just stand for a minute to pay our respects. Thank you. Thank you. Okay, so can I once again welcome everybody to this meeting of Cabinet. I'm pleased to see that I think I'm right in saying there's quite a few students from Cllr here today. I think Matthew, I'm going to ask you just to explain a little bit about what brings them here at a cold Monday morning to hear comments.
Absolutely, thank you, Chair. I mean, obviously, what brings them here is the fascinating agenda items that we've got today, I'm sure. But it's Brendan Burns, who is one of the lecturers at Liverpool Institute of Performing Arts. And last year, Wirral was fortunate enough to have their Theatre Democracy project come to Wirral. They work with a number of our community groups to really portray some of the views of the groups that are operating on Wirral. And I'm delighted that we secured them to come back for a second year. And what I found fascinating last year was some of their observations of the meetings that we ourselves hold, how open and engaging they are. So I think this is part of our ongoing commitment to localism and engagement, and I'm delighted they're here and offering a warm welcome on behalf of us all.
Yeah, okay, well said. And can I add my thanks for them coming, and you're very welcome. I hope you enjoy this meeting. So let's go into the agenda. Just one change that I could announce right at the start of the meeting. We are deferring item 6, the All Age Disability and Mental Health Full Business Case. There's a bit more work on this before we bring it back to Cabinet. So that's deferred to our, hopefully, our next meeting. So let's go straight into agenda item number 1, which is Members' Code of Conduct, Declarations of Interest. Are there any? No? Okay. I should have given apologies to Councillor Burnley Mooney. I could ask for them to be recorded. She's not able to be here today. Item 2 of minutes from the last meeting. Can we agree that I signed them as a true record?
Yes.
Okay, so that takes us then on to item 3. Executive key decisions taken under delegated powers. Don't believe there are any. Okay. So that takes us on to item 4. This is the strategic regeneration framework. If I could just say a few words by way of introduction for this document. So, strategic regeneration framework kind of sets the roadmap really for where we are going generation in the borough over the next, not just, you know, a few years, but 10, 20 years. It's very much in line with our 20 pledges, and particularly picks up on the three pledges that relate to business and growth, namely creating greater job opportunities in Wirral, improving the environment for small businesses, so we have a thriving small business community, and thirdly, increasing inward investment. And we have got in the Wirral plan, as you know, some very specific targets around those three pledges. The strategic regeneration framework does provide that kind of vision for how we're going to deliver those three pledges over the next 10 to 15 years. And critically, it's going to be the key document which informs the development of the Wirral Growth Company, which we've talked about at Cabinet on many occasions in the past. I think it's a very exciting vision. I've always said as a leader, it's important that we're ambitious for the Wirral. We have got fantastic natural assets, we've got fantastic culture and history and heritage in the borough. We've got some tremendous businesses, not just the big blue chip companies, Cllr and Unilever. We've got a really thriving small business community. We've got a very active Wirral Chamber, one of the fastest growing chambers in the country. And, you know, we are now part of a wider Liverpool City region and a combined authority with exciting plans for developing the infrastructure there. So one of the things that I'm involved in with Steve Rotherham is looking at the possibility of a tidal barrage on the river. And as my portfolio also covers culture, we're also looking at an exciting agenda around events for 2018, Giants coming back to Merseyside and Wirral, which is great news. And also, I'm very keen, and you know, Councillor Chris Spriggs has been working on this, to encourage and promote a thriving arts and culture industry sector within Wirral. And I think there are lots of opportunities for doing that. The Strategic Regeneration Framework sets out met all of these opportunities within the covers of one document, focusing not just on, you know, the opportunities around the waterfront in Birkenhead and Hamilton Square and Birkenhead Town Centre, but many other parts of the borough, Wallasey and other opportunities around the A41 and elsewhere. I think hopefully by the turn of the year, when we've agreed our investor development part as part of our joint venture company, we will then have all the pieces in place to really forge ahead with a very exciting kind of regeneration agenda, where we will be bringing in significant new jobs and investment opportunities. Now that's important because we want to grow the economy, you know, that's a key priority for this council. But we also know that given that government funding will disappear completely by 2021, we need to generate additional income, and we can only do that through either building more houses, attracting more council tax receipts, creating more businesses, and getting more business rates. So I see this document as being good for the growth, identifying where the growth is going to come from in the borough, but also vital in terms of those important income streams that we need to bring on board, because by 2020 we will effectively be self-sufficient, because the government is saying to local authorities after that date, you're on your own, there will be no more central government support. Now that is a fairly daunting prospect, but we need to start preparing the ground now for when that we fall off that cliff edge. And it's not just Wirral, it's all authorities in the north particularly that are affected by this. So I see the kind of foundations that we're putting in place through the strategic regeneration framework, and then the mechanism for delivering all this, the Wirral Growth Company, as being the mechanism, if you like, that we're going to do to make sure that our vital public services can be continued after the government grant is withdrawn completely in 2021. It's that important, I think. So, not necessarily going to talk about the detail of this, because it's a very detailed document, and members will have had an opportunity to peruse it. Just to give anybody the opportunity to ask any questions or make any contributions before I turn to the recommendations. George?
Yeah, thank you, Fran. I think, first of all, I'd like to say that this is a really exciting document for Will. And as someone who's been around a long time and seen how the towns have fallen away since the 1980s, when we lost, if you like, the docks, we lost Cllr, we lost a lot of things to automation as well. So over the years, we've seen a dramatic change, and what the, as one old reporter actually calls us now, the crusty old town of Birkenhead, and it needs a lift, and I think the time has come to see that, and hopefully this will be the stimulus to get that underway, and I hope to see at least 15 to 20 years of regeneration to bring Will back to its former glory. That's all I have to say.
Thanks, George. Matthew?
Thank you, Phil. Just wanted to commend the report. I think it's really important that we have a good strategy for the reasons you set out about the continued government austerity. That doesn't look like it's going to be letting up anytime soon. But one of the things I think is really positive about this is the partnership approach, the idea that actually Rural Council is going to lead the way and guide the path. But we can't do it ourselves, so we're going to be utilising the officers' time, our resources, our influence, but also bringing the private sector, third sector, and public sector bodies to support our vision for Wirral. I think there's a real opportunity here that gives us an opportunity to shape Wirral. That if we actually weren't doing this, it would just be left purely to the investors and private sector. And I think this is actually quite a bold and ambitious document that makes it quite an attractive opportunity for a lot of people to invest in Wirral. I just wondered if you could again touch upon, I know you raised it, if you could again touch upon the economic situation, the amount of money we've lost, and the amount of money we are going to continue to lose, because I think it just shows just how vitally important bringing extra money into the world is when we hear about specific figures or services.
Well, you know, it's been well trailed that by 2021, the government will have cut our budget to the tune of about 250 million. You know, so that is a massive, massive proportion of our budget that has been withdrawn. And, you know, that has, as everybody knows, that has huge ramifications for how we can deliver good public services going forward. It's why we've got such a big emphasis on transformation, because the old model of doing everything centrally and from the council, that is effectively broken. We need to come up with more innovative and creative ways of making sure that those vital public services are delivered. So we do face huge financial problems. And you know, the thing that always frustrates me is when you talk to our counterparts in the south of the country, that they don't have the same pressures. I've said on many occasions, the government have, I think, really been extremely unfair in the way they have cut budgets, and I still don't understand how politically, morally, ethically, whatever you want to call it, it can be justifiable that the areas of the country like Wirral and like Merseyside with the highest levels of deprivation and poverty get the biggest cuts. I can't understand how that can be defendable in anybody's language. So we are, you're quite right, Matthew, we are still, you know, we are still under the pressure of a government that is practicing austerity. And you know, I hope that changes soon. I hope that we get a more enlightened government that actually believes in good public services, and you know, public servants that are properly rewarded for the fantastic work that they do. But until then, we've got to we've got to be is we've got to work smarter to make sure that those vital public services can continue, and the strategic regeneration framework is an important way in which we can do that. I've said on many occasions that we've got to move away from the old model where we just sold a piece of land, that the developer realised the benefit and the council doesn't get anything. So the Wirral Growth Company and the work that is summarised in this document will enable us to share from the proceeds of any future regeneration. And I think that's important. So we're not going to be selling, you know, contrary to popular opinion, we're not selling any of our assets, but we will make sure that any economic benefits from any of the regeneration projects that are referenced in this document, the council will continue to enjoy a financial benefit from. And that's important because we can put that directly back into our services for our residents. And that's I think, the kind of thinking we need to put in place now for when the government grant is withdrawn completely. And, you know, I think sometimes we don't sufficiently emphasise how big a shock that will create. You know, the idea that the grant that central government has historically for hundreds of years provided for local authorities will be withdrawn completely is a massive, massive change to the local government landscape. And I do worry that unless councils start planning for this now, some of them may well fall over financially after 2021. Because I don't see if you can't replace that grant with something else, how you can sustain all of your services. So this is, I think, good, prudent planning for the future, as well as being, you know, as well as being good in itself in terms of bringing in extra jobs and investment to work. So I think it's important that we agree this document, and as I say, it will very much feed into the work that Rural Growth Company is going to be doing once we've agreed our private sector developer investor. Anything else that anybody wants to say on this? If not, can I ask you to look at the recommendations on page 2 of the agenda? So we're being asked to endorse the strategic regeneration framework. To be used to support the regeneration activity and the ambitions of the Rural Growth Company, the Rural City Region Strategy and Future Funding Applications. And it will, by recommendation 2, we will recommend to Council that the SRF, Strategic Regeneration Framework, be adopted as a material planning consideration in relation to development proposals, and that the document also be used to inform the content of the emerging core strategy local plan. So those recommendations. Can I ask if they're agreed? Secretary Jones, is that agreed? Okay, that's agreed. Thank you very much for that. Okay, so we move on to the next item, which is item 5, which is the annual report of the Director of Public Health and Wellbeing, who's very conveniently sitting next to me. Welcome, Cllr. Well, I'm going to ask Chris Jones, the Cabinet member who oversees this, to introduce the report and have a discussion. Thanks, Chris.
Thank you, Phil. So this is Cllr Eireann's Director of Public Health's annual report. Each year, the report focuses on adverse impacts on health. So previously, we had social isolation and domestic violence. And this year, it's called Expect Better. And it's actually reporting on and focusing on avoidable deaths. And basically, it supports the delivery of the Wirral 2020 plan and pledge Wirral residents live healthier lives, which is one of my pledges. But it also obviously impacts on other pledges as well. But what the report does, it informs the public and local services of the principal cause of avoidable deaths. And I think I'm sure you've all read the report, but some of the graphs are really highlighting the inequality between the eastern and western Wirral. And as a Labour cabinet and a Labour group, is something we've been really concerned about for a very long time, that the gap is really not closing. And I think what this report does, and there's an animated sort of cartoon to go with it, which unfortunately we can't show this morning because it's not been downloaded. and this will go into doctor's surgeries, to highlight really what people can do to help themselves to live a healthier life. Because although people are living longer, they're now living for decades sometimes with real, you know, health problems. So it's just simple messages really to pass on to people. But this report also challenges us as a system. So, and all the health organisations on Wirral, social care as well, voluntary sector, as well as people themselves. And I think, you know, one of the things for me that this report highlighted was people in the poor areas of Wirral received fewer invitations to go for health checks. This sort of thing that really, you know, it's not just expectations of people, because I think sometimes people in poorer areas, actually, their expectations are not as great as the other side of the middle. I think Shirley's magically
found it
for us, so shall we just have a quick react, please? See the sort of thing, you can't hear it, but there is a link in the page if people would like to go have a look. But basically, you know, it does really highlight the inequalities on the world. It's a ridiculous thing, but on such a small peninsula, that those inequalities are there. So it's just telling people, really, you know, it's talking about diet, it's talking about smoking, alcohol, just things that people can do a little bit, you know, for themselves as well, rather than have everything done for them. This is a communication plan to share the report and the film, as I say, to all the stakeholders. I quite like these pictures, they're just great. It just sort of brings it to life. Maybe I sound happy, sad of them. So can I ask Cabinet to support the communication of the annual report through the report itself and through the thank you.
Thanks, Chris. Given that Fiona's sitting next to me and she's the author of this report, I think it would be a good opportunity just to ask Fiona if she wants to add anything to what Chris has said, because it's, you know, you've authored this report, Chris. So do you want to just say a few words, please?
Thank you, and thank you, Chris, for introducing the report. I really welcome it being here at Cabinet, because it is a chance for us to set ourselves a bit of a challenge locally, collectively. As you were saying, these inequalities have been for an awfully long time, and very often it can just become that this is just how it is round here. I think we need to challenge that expectation. It can be different. And the reason we focus on avoidable deaths is because there is something that can be done about those. And so the report really does call on everyone who can play a part in making a difference in that. So that ranges from health professionals expecting their patients to do well and therefore taking the action to deliver that, to people wanting something positive for themselves and expecting better for themselves, because I think if you just expect that's what life is like, it might not seem unusual, but actually there is a chance for people to have much better quality of life. This isn't about extending life forever, but as you were saying, people are living a long time in very poor health. The more we can do to reduce that, the better. Better for those individuals, and that's what it's really all about. So it is a bit of a call to sort of say, let's not just accept this variation across our borough, because actually there are things we can do. So I think all our efforts should continue to be focused on making that difference.
Thank you. Right, comments, questions? Jan.
Thanks, Chris, thanks, Fiona. I think this is really fantastic, you know. it still shocks me when I do read the statistics about mortality rates and the difference in them between more affluent parts of the borough and the least. And it drives home that actually, you know, poverty and deprivation and, you know, poor housing, etc., absolutely have an impact on people's health. And so I'm really pleased that we're kind of targeting, you're targeting those people in the poorer parts of the borough. Because whilst the governments are continually increasing such state pension age, in theory, getting people to work longer sounds on the face of it, oh, well, that's fine because everyone's living long. But actually, there's going to be a lot of people that may not get to retirement age, might just get there and not live much longer because they're in such poor health. And they're going to affect the poorer people in the borough. So I think this is great. And I do like the bottom box there that says, act like you're rich. So I'm certainly going to start doing that from now on.
Okay.
Thank
you. Other comments? Angie?
Yes, this is an excellent report. You do need to be aspirational for people, don't we? You know, and I think there's a really good balance. It makes a link between kind of physical health and mental health as well, which is so important. I do have one question. It's around the health checks that GP practices offer, and I just wanted to ask what work was being done to kind of make sure that those health checks are available and that people are getting invited to them.
Thank you. At the moment, we're just, because we're not satisfied with that, we're just in the process of recommissioning our health checks programme with an emphasis on actually focusing on those people who aren't taking up that offer. So what those people who are coming forward to offer to provide those will have to demonstrate is just how they're going to reach out to the people who aren't yet taking up the offer, because there will be those who will just come, but actually are interested in the maybe oncoming. Some people might not come because they feel fine, but other people are missing a chance to perhaps have an assessment which could help them make some decisions about their health and work with our primary care colleagues to make a difference on them.
Matthew?
Thank you, Beth. Just a follow-up question on that. I've read here it's all. It's a place to be. If you're aged 40 to 74 with a previous history of cardiovascular disease, you're eligible for a free health check every 5 years at your GP practice. And Angie just touched upon that. And I know some figures were between, that's page 101 of the internet. I know the figures we're looking to improve. Would you have a figure about that? I don't know if you'd be able to share with us now, but the breakdown was by award. I think Janette picked up before about discrepancies in terms of sort of wealth inequalities and how that comes through in terms of life expectancy. I wonder if we'd also see the wealth inequality show that a fewer people in the poor areas are actually taking that up. But it'd be quite interesting piece of information if you could circulate that to us afterwards if you had it.
Anybody else? Okay. Can I just sort of don't want to sort of repeat what other people said, but I think, you know, this highlights probably the most pressing challenge that we face at closing those health inequalities between particularly the east and the west of the borough. You know, what always amazes me is if you look at a map of deprivation and ill health, it's hardly changed in kind of 30 years in Wirral. So I think it's important that we keep this as the, you know, the highest priority we've got, because I believe it is. The other point I want to make is, can I link the previous report, which has been considered, to this as well? Because one of the as well as the issues that this report highlights about the lifestyle, etc., it is equally important that we target our economic efforts to get people back into work at those poorest communities. And I know we all around this table absolutely determined that when we are creating jobs and we are bringing new investment opportunities into rural, that we make sure that as far as we can, that those communities who with the highest levels of unemployment I've got a good chance of getting those job opportunities. So I think there is a direct connection between, and we've talked about this many times, haven't we, Fiona, the wider determinants of health around employment, housing, leisure, etc. We link all of these things together. So I think there is a direct connection between the growth that we've just been talking about in the strategic regeneration framework of the growth company and addressing this issue that is the main focus of Fiona's annual report. So I just wanted to kind of flag that up as well. But I think we've got to continue to focus on this issue because it is, I think, probably the biggest challenge that the public faces going forward. And if we can start to narrow that gap in inequality between that's what our legacy we will leave for our children and our grandchildren. Yeah? Okay, so the recommendation on page 72 is that we support, we agree the annual report and support the communication of the annual report. And there's a very comprehensive plan for how we roll the information out to all our partners and to the public. And there is a link in the report, a hyperlink to the YouTube, but people hopefully can have a look at the animation, the sound as well. Okay, so can we agree that recommendation? Is that great? Okay, thanks to Fiona for an excellent report. Okay, so I've not been informed of any other business. No? So can I close the meeting? And thank you for your attendance. Thank you.
Thank you very much.